So now we'll move on to the next talk. The next talk is by Steve Tene. It's a cloud native engineer at Container, and he will be talking to us about GitOps made simple with Flux. So go ahead, take it over. Thank you.
Hello everyone, thanks for joining. I'm Steve, software engineer at Container Solutions, and today we are going to talk about GitOps and how we can easily do it using Flux CD. So Container Solutions is a consultancy company located in Amsterdam, London, Zurich, Berlin, Montreal, Warsaw, and we help companies migrate to the cloud. That can go from an assessment step till the implementation steps and also the SRE using our professional services. I'm a software engineer, 5 years of experience in software development using Java, Spring Boot, Spring Cloud. And I'm a DevOps enthusiast, so I really like automation tools and enjoy all the challenges behind orchestration and automation. On the agenda today, we are going to first of all talk about CI/CD. We are going to see a basic CI/CD pipeline. We are going to talk then about GitOps, what is GitOps, what are the key concepts in GitOps. We are going to see a GitOps pipeline, how to operate. Then we are going to introduce Flux and see the benefits and limitations of Flux CD. And at the end, we are going to do a demo. So CI/CD pipeline, let's start. So we have a basic CI/CD pipeline where the developer needs to push a new code and you want to make that code available in, for example, the dev environment. So what happens is that he changed the code, pushed the code onto a branch, and then you have a set of steps that are triggered on the CI/CD pipeline in order to make that code available. First of all, you can have unit tests that are run against that code, and sometimes you also have integration tests. You can have acceptance tests also if you want. And then after that, you have a compilation phase where the code is compiled. And then you have a build phase where the code is built and made available. It can be made available using an Artifactory in case of a source code, or it can be made available using Docker containers registries in case of a Docker image or a Docker container. That's for the integration step. And then we have to make that code available. So we have to push that new code onto the server, onto the cluster, or the environment. So what happened at that step is that some companies, what they are doing is that they are pushing the code right away straight to the environment. Some other companies create extra pull requests in order to have that code merge into a branch that is binded to, not actually binded, that to a branch that is reflecting the state of the environment, the belonging environment. So what is happening is that you can create your pull request. For example, okay, I have this new code, I have this new version, I want to deploy it in this environment. Someone to approve it, and then you wait for the deployment. And when the deployment is done, there's someone that can go in the environment and just test, do some smoke test to make sure that everything is fine. So yeah, you have to keep in mind that first of all, to be able to deploy in the environment, we need to have a CI tool and an access. That means that in case we are using, for example, Jenkins, we need to make sure that Jenkins has access to the cluster in order to deploy the new code in the cluster. So that's first for the first one. The second one, in case of a disaster on your cluster, sometimes you have to retrigger all your pipelines in order to redeploy the same code. So you see that there's a small management overhead there, because on the first side, you have to manage your, when if you think about access keys management, you have to manage your keys on the Jenkins side, but also on the cluster side, because if you want to rotate your keys on the cluster side, then you have to copy the key back in the Jenkins in order for him to be able to deploy new code the next time. So after this CI/CD pipeline, now we are going to go to GitOps and see what benefits GitOps brings us in this hope, in this pipeline, or in this world, or in achieving or in deploying this new code in the environment. So GitOps is really about operation by pull request. That's the main idea behind GitOps is that you do not have access to the cluster. You do not access your cluster to do changes or to deploy new code. So what is GitOps? GitOps is an operating model where changes to infrastructure, including application deployment, are managed via a version control system. So here we have to pinpoint three things. First of all, the infrastructure. Secondly, the application deployment. And third, the version control system. So the key concept behind GitOps are, first, you declaratively describe the entire desired state of your system. Then, the desired state of your system is versioned in Git. You do operations by pull requests, and then you have some software agents that can ensure correctness and alert in case of divergence. So the first one is declaratively describing the entire desired state of the system. So by doing that, you guarantee that the configuration is guaranteed by a set of facts instead of a set of instructions. So for example, Kubernetes tool is a cloud native tool that is declarative and that can be treated as code. When applying a manifest to the cluster, you are telling Kubernetes, okay, for example, I want 10 pods of Nginx server running in this namespace. So you are not telling Kubernetes, in this case, how to achieve that state. You are telling him that you want 10 pods of Nginx running in this environment. So it's up to Kubernetes to find out how to make the desired state match the actual state. The desired state is versioned in Git. So because the entire system is described in Git, we have Git as the single source of truth from which you can recover in case of disaster. So if there's a disaster on your cluster, you know that, okay, what was the state of my cluster before the disaster? What was the application deployed into and the version of those applications? Then you can go back to your Git repository and see, oh, these are all the manifests. Okay, this is what my environment was looking like. Then you can easily replicate it, and then you can easily redeploy things to the environment. So by doing that, you are reducing your mean time to recovery from hours to minutes. Operation by pull request. Approved changes are automatically applied to the system. That means that there is no unnecessary access to the cluster. You don't need unnecessary access to the cluster in order to deploy or to apply the changes. Once changes are approved by pull request, changes are automatic, or the new code is almost automatically available in the cluster. Software agents to ensure correctness and alert on divergence. So here, what we are talking about, the state of our system. The state of our system here is kept under version control. That means that you should have some software running your cluster that can actually alert you if the desired state does not equal the actual state, or whatever your expectations are not met. Now we are going to talk about GitOps pipeline. So when we want to do GitOps, we have to think about two things. First of all, the build phase and the GitOps workflow. As we saw, for example, in the previous steps, in the first CI/CD pipeline step, we have a build phase where the development team pushes new code to the Git, and then you have a build server that will take that code build it, test it, and package it, and then make it available. And then on the GitOps workflow, what will happen is that you have to do a pull request. You have a configuration, you have all your configuration defined. You create a pull request with all the changes you want to do. Let's say you have in your configuration file or your manifest, you have Nginx version 1. After the build phase is finished, you have Nginx version 2 that is available. You do a pull request, you change, okay, now I want the Nginx version 2, and then you do a pull request. What happened then is that you have someone that will review your pull request, and if it's fine, it will just merge it and everything will be deployed to the cluster. So, in summary, that build, if you go back, that build, test, and package phase can be resumed into a build phase. So we have in total 2 pull requests to do. Major times you have 2 pull requests to do. Because when you have a development team, each developer is branching from the main branch. That means that at the end they have to do a pull request in order to have their code merge in the main branch. So when their code is merged, someone is reviewing the code, and then you have the build phase run on the build server, and then you have the new code available or the new artifact available. And then there's the second pull request that is done against the configuration, the environment configuration that is described declaratively in a Git repository. You have a reviewer that will see or look at it and say, okay, yes, this is fine. And then we just approve it. And once you approve it, changes will be deployed in the cluster. So now we are going to see 11 reasons for adopting GitOps. First of all, stored history of environment changes. Since the application environment configuration is stored in Git repository, any changes to the environment is tracked. So you have a clear history of all what changed and why things change. Secondly, easy rollback to a previous state. Since you have a clear log from Git and you can leverage on Git in order to have some functionalities that like revert, commit, and everything, you can then rollback to a previous state of your cluster by reverting a commit. So let's say there's the last commit, there's a bug in the last commit, all you have to do is to revert the commit and then the new state will be applied to the cluster. Secure deployment, no CI access anymore. So your CI to your build server, there's no access, your build server does not have access to the cluster anymore. That means that you are changing the RO site. Users do not have access to the cluster, and the CI also does not have access to the cluster. That way, approval process. In the GitOps world, you can have a configuration where the pull request is done by one team, and the approval is done by another team. So you can have the guys from operations say, okay, this is the pull request. The developer did, okay, it's fine, then approves it, and then things are deployed in the cluster. So you really have separations of responsibilities there. Module architecture. Actually, GitOps has 3 parts. First of all, you have the Git repo. Then after the Git repo, you have the deployment process. And after the deployment process, you have a process that automates the version update. So that means that you can decide to change part independently. The things are not really, really, really coupled. Tool independent architecture. That means that, for example, let's say the deployment phase or the deployment process, you can decide, okay, today you are using Jenkins, you can decide, okay, tomorrow I'm going to use Travis CI, for example, or Bitbucket pipelines, if you want. Because at the end of that deployment phase, what is made available is the Docker container or the new artifact in an artifact repository. 7, reuse existing knowledge. Since all the system is based on Git, you are not learning a new tool in order to do the GitOps. you can already leverage on Git, since many developers knows about Git, many people knows about Git. You are using this Git tool in order to achieve GitOps. It compare different environments. So, for example, in case you have two different branches, one for dev, one for staging, for example. You can compare these two branches and see what are the differences between the state in the dev environment and the state in the staging environment. Backups come out of the box. Everything is declared and stored in the Git repositories. So you already have a backup in case there's a failure on the cluster or a disaster on the cluster. You only have to reconnect the cluster using the GitOps approach, reconnect it to the Git repository, and everything will be reapplied again. So you already have a backup mechanism out of the box. Testing changes like application code. So here, all the changes that are tested and the user application, all the changes here are tested like application code, in the sense that you can decide to do a pull request in order to push new changes in the environment, and then you can have a CI tool that goes against that pull request and do some tests before giving a green light, and everything can be approved and deployed to the cluster. Highly available deployment infrastructure. So what is happening is that most of Git repository servers are usually already set up in a replicated way. That means that you don't have to do any sort of configuration to make sure that all your backups are pretty safe. So now we are going to talk about Flux, which is a GitOps Kubernetes operator. So the key concept around Flux are, first of all, Flux is an operator. So it runs inside the Kubernetes cluster and it triggers deployment from within the Kubernetes cluster. Then you have an automated Git cluster synchronization. Here, what is happening is that in case there's something that's changing in the cluster, it needs to be reflected in the Git repository. And in case something changes in the Git repository, it needs to be reflected in the cluster. So there's an automated, you need to have an automated synchronization. And that's what Flux brings here. No CI access to be granted to the cluster anymore. Because Flux is running inside the cluster and connected directly to the repository, you don't need to give CI access anymore to, for example, Jenkins in order to deploy code. You only have to change a manifest, and then Flux will detect that something changed, and then you pull it and apply it to the cluster. Automated deployment of new container images. In case you have new containers that are pushed maybe from your local machine, or maybe from an old legacy CI system, you can decide, okay, you can let Flux deploy that new container in your cluster also. So there's two main functionalities using Flux. There's a connection to the Git repository on one side, and there's a connection to the Docker container registry on the other side. Flux can monitor both in order to make the desired state match the actual state. Garbage collections. If we have some resources that we want to remove or that are removed from the Git repository and you want them to be removed from the cluster, Flux can achieve that. You can take your new manifest, see that, okay, you remove these resources, and then he will do the cleanup in the cluster for you. So, in this diagram, you see that Flux is in the middle. That is, Flux is connected to the push, or to the Docker container registry, connected to the Git repository, and also connected to the Kubernetes API. What will happen in case there's a new image that is pushed on the Docker image repository, Flux will detect it. First, you update the Git repository, because the Git is the single source of truth. And then you apply that changes to the cluster. So that's how things work. You will not deploy the new container before changing the version in the Git repository. So to finish, we are going to talk a bit about limitations of Flux. Right now, Flux can only deal with one repository at a time. So you have to, if you have 10 applications in the cluster, you have to make sure that those the manifests related to those 10 applications are inside the same repository. And you made that repository available to Flux. You can decide, you can tell Flux, okay, to scan only a subdirectory in the repository if you want. Two-hour Kubernetes manifest should explicitly specify the target namespace. Otherwise, the default namespace will be assumed. First, we know directories are hand chars. So because if you have, for example, chars.yaml or values.yaml in your directory, first will detect it as a hand chart, and then you skip it. Fourth, first will not be able to get metadata from a private registry available by using localhost. So in case you have a private registry listening on localhost, Flux will not be able to get to pull metadata as if your registry was the private or the public Docker hub, for example. And the last one, multi-tenancy. Flux does not come with a built-in multi-tenancy mechanism, but there's a way to achieve that. There's a way to manage your configuration in order to achieve that. I see that we are running out of time, so I will skip the demo and talk a bit about what next. What's next? Actually, the first line, you can check out a blog post I wrote on the new stack. It's called GitOps Made Simple with Flux as this presentation. Then you have the public page of Flux CD. You can check out the documentation, really well written documentation. You can also go to Weaveworks website and see and learn more about GitOps. And that's pretty much it. Thanks for joining today. I hope you enjoyed. And feel free to send questions or feel free to share your advices. And thank you. Bye.
Hello. Thank you for this awesome talk, Steve. Is Steve online?
Yes.
Hey, Steve. Awesome. Great talk on the GitOps flow with using Flux. It's an awesome talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We do have some questions from the attendees. And one of them it would be, how would you handle stateful workloads on a GitOps manner?
Okay, so for stateful workloads, I think the first question that we have to maybe ask ourselves is related to state management, because using GitOps is really easy to achieve progressive delivery when it's stateless applications. In the case of stateful workloads, if your state is managed inside the application, it'll be a little bit tricky. That's why I think the first issue to address would be how the state is managed. And for that, there's ways actually to put the state out of the application. So when the state is out of the application, you can easily use some progressive delivery tool. For example, Weaveworks came out with a flagger with a progressive delivery tool. So you can use that, or you can also use some service meshes in order to do to leverage on routing, so that some state, the old state will stick on the old application and the new state will go on the new application. And Perfect. Then GitOps will be only about changing the application version.
Awesome. Thank you for clarifying this, Steve. And we do have another question from Keith Colborne. And it's more in general, and we often see this question coming along, is in organization, on bigger organization, there's often the dev team, the ops team. And the question would be like more like, when should the ops team be involved? At which process of the GitOps workflow should they be considered? Is it at the dev stage and going from on, or is it only at a later stage that they should be technically onboarded into the process?
So I think it really depends on how the team are structured, because there's some companies who where the developer are responsible on team production, so they have access to to, for example, the environment variables, so all the keys in order to deploy into production and manage the application. And in some organizations, they are actually the developers are managing application to QA, and you have some other people who are taking the application and deploying to production. So first of all, it really depends on how the company structure itself. And if I want to take a similar example for the, as I was talking about the environment variables, usually people that are managing production clusters doesn't want that developers get access to environment variables data in production. So sometimes they'll hide it, or maybe they'll host it on another server or inside configuration server. So in case you have like a declarative application, you have a manifest where you are managing your applications, your environment variable using, for example, a config map. You can have your environment variables inside that manifest right away. But you have another example where you need to connect to a config server in production in order to get those environment variables. So I would say where you get involved, it really depends on how the team is structured. If there's no problem for them to get access to everything, then they can get involved in any stage. But if you want to hide some things to the developers because of security or because of some other concerns, then they will really be involved in the later stage. And there's another impact on the deployment process also, because if they are involved in the later stage, how issues will be handled in case there's a problem or something like that. So it really depends. It really depends on how the team is structured.
Perfect. Thank you for clarifying this point. We do have one question that often comes, and often at meetups, I have a lot of customers and friends that keep on asking me the question. And it goes about, we often try to revoke access from developers and from the CI to don't have access to the code and don't have access to the kubectl directly. So to make sure that everything goes from GitOps, and GitOps and the pipeline will apply directly into your cluster. And this would be a dream state to achieve. But do you know any applications or any products that we should, if we adopt this mindset, we still need to have a view and allow developers to view what's going on or how their deployment is going? Is there any tools that you're made aware of that is maybe good practice to start using if this is something they would like to achieve?
Personally, on top of my head, I don't see a tool. The thing is that using GitOps, developers don't have access to kubectl anymore. So they only have to do their pull request and have everything in the cluster. Then if you don't want them to have access to the cluster, for example, to check logs, for example, you have to grab the logs out of the cluster and make it available, maybe using Datadog or some other tools. So I think you have to identify all what you've done, all what the developer needs to see or to get access in the cluster, and find tools outside the cluster that can manage that. And then you can revoke all the kubectl access.
Perfect. Thank you, Steve. This was the last question. I know that there is still one question in the Q&A box. I think you do have access to the Q&A box. Steve, if you don't mind, just answer it. It will be awesome. It was a question from Sammy. And I would like to thank again for your time and the awesome video you demonstrated for all the attendees. Have an awesome day.
Thank you.